Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andrei Lenik. Today we will talk about API testing and so a few words about me. So I'm a senior QA automation engineer in DataArt. I have been working in this area for about 10 years. I had different roles. And a few years ago, I defended investigation in theoretical physics of water. So I have a PhD level in science. So let's start with our topic. Briefly, we will talk about testing levels. Most of you somehow have experience with HTTP protocol or some kinds of web services, but I think it would be better to repeat some important points here. We will talk about such tools like Postman, like SOAP UI. I will give you some more tool names, and maybe we can discuss what are pros and cons of every tool. And then at the end, this topic is so big that it's impossible to cover every tool, every deep point of such big topic. So I prepared some deep points with examples in SOAP UI today. The second part will be connected with SOAP UI and some interesting topics that are not covered in usual tutorials. At the end of every part, I will propose you just small task, and you can just open these slides. Open this task and create your simple tests. Let's talk about test duration in general. In your projects, if we are talking about UI testing, how long is an average test? Who can say? So 1 minute. How many pages are opened during this 1 minute? 2-3. So 1 page per 30 seconds, is it a good performance for a website? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I agree with you that in the worst cases, such cases can be can take minutes or even in some bad cases, tens of minutes. But if everything is good with the environment, so the test can take dozens of seconds, but in good conditions. Have you ever thought about for example, to automate some routine operations like login, for example, or maybe user registrations, and made them much faster than they can be done via UI? So, mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, and I would like to know, so could you raise a hand if you are a manual QA engineer? And could you write a hand, raise a hand if you are automated QA engineer? So, and guys who are automation engineers, do you have experience with API testing? Okay. Okay. So maybe I will show you something interesting with SOAPY, but so maybe you have some experience. Okay. So let's talk about different levels of testing. So we have UI testing. We have API testing, for example, integration testing. Here we are not talking about unit testing because in many cases it is like this is a developer's area. So if we are talking about UI testing, I think that this is like a good case when duration of an API takes like tens or hundreds of milliseconds, and at the same time UI tests can be like hundreds of seconds long and more, and more in bad cases that we were talking about. So, and very important question that your UI test in many cases it can be broken because not only UI but because of the API. So if it breaks, sometimes it's difficult to say why it is broken just from the report. So so if you are using just API tests, not only UI tests but API tests as well, so you can separate some causes from your UI tests, for example. And one important topic. So, in your project, do you use this correlation between different levels of tests? Do you know the names of the bad models in this case? Yes, so it is just a model of relationship between different levels. Do you have any idea? So maybe you saw, so there are this one, ice cream cone. So this is vice versa because here you can see that very small number of unit tests, bigger number of automated tests and some cloud. In some bad cases, this cloud can be really huge. And another model is just cupcake. So you have a lot of unit tests, a lot of automated tests, a lot of manual tests, and everything is like in a mess. So you can't decrease your number of tests and like your efforts on testing. So could anybody say why do we need this correlation?
Right.
Okay, this would be very nice if we have very small number of UI tests and bigger numbers of API and unit tests. But probably sometimes it would be in some cases it depends on the customer, and our task is to show this testing pyramid and to describe why should we use this. Okay. And today, so we will talk about this level. So we won't talk about UI or unit tests. And if we are talking about this pyramid, could you say why do we need such correlation? So we were talking about separation of the causes, and what else? Firstly, our efforts can be very big on UI tests. So for to create some unit tests, you just of course you should be like should have developers knowledge, but it's really simple and not so even if we compare like duration. These tests are very fast, and these tests are very slow. So this can be executed during just milliseconds sometimes, and this can be executed in some bad cases during the whole night or more. So that is why, and the next slide. So UI tests are very slow, and unit tests are very fast. Let's talk about web services, about API. So just a few a few points that maybe you know, but I would like to repeat them. Web services in general, it's like something that connects two machines, two software applications, or maybe some hardware part with an application. Without something that can be computed without human. And today we will talk mostly about SOAP web services and RESTful web services. Of course, there are like XML RPC or JSON RPC or maybe something more complicated things. But I think in 99% we won't met with them. Some people won't met even with SOAP, I think. If we are talking about web services, this is something that can be working automatically, and our client on any platform can communicate automatically with this for example application. Partially this can be just a part of a website. So a website can be open in a browser, in web browser. And a few more details about HTTP transfer protocol. This is like if we have like network, general network model. This is an application layer, and this is one of protocols on these layers. And see that for REST it is like application layer protocol. For SOAP it can be just something in the middle between application and transport protocol, because it can be used by it is used by, like transport. And it is like stateless, connectionless, etc. And for HTTP, very important things are like headers, body, response code, encodings, and of course version, because nowadays, who knows which HTTP version or HTTP clients are connected with the last Java version. Sorry? Oh, yes, correct, 2.0, yes. And HTTP headers can be, so there are, can be many possible headers, and who can say what is it, what's this cookie? Someone knows. Sorry? Yes, session. So we store session details in this cookie, and using this cookie, for example, if we are in some mail box or some social network, we can. So this application can know that we are logged in or not, for example. HTTP methods. So there are a lot of possible HTTP methods. So here you can see not all of them, just a few of them. Why do you think I highlighted these four? In REST, yes, correct. So these four methods, sometimes only two of them, so just POST and GET. But in most widely used places, only two of them, but sometimes these four. Of course, there are RESTful web services that use others, but these four would be like good... good RESTful service. So and so RESTful web services are not just, it's not like a protocol, it's like a type of architecture. So we are using just methods of HTTP that I mentioned on the previous slide. And we are not using just some complicated protocol, additional protocol. And we using all that we have in HTTP protocol. And I prepared just a few examples of REST, public REST services. So you can just, for example, open, we have like Narodowy Bank Polski, for example. Let's open this. So, just a second. Sorry for this. How can I? Okay. In general, you can just Google and find a lot of open web services if you want just have some examples and have some practice. So here you can see like user manual, and you can see some examples. For example, rates, exchange rates. Well, some information about gold I saw here, and in the bottom you can see, so there is like example. For example, we can find this exchange rate, for example. So I'm sorry. So here you can see that the result is opened. You can see some result in JSON format, and not in JSON, in XML, yes, in XML form. And probably other requests and responses can look like this. So you can take some information and somehow process this. And in many cases, you can analyze not only this body, but analyze some, for example, headers as well. So you can use, if we need, just you can analyze headers, you can analyze status code, and your test, we will see further how can we process all this data automatically in some tools, like for example SOAP UI or others. Just a second. For REST, there are the most important points of REST are endpoint, resource, methods that we were talking about, media type of data. So in many cases we have like JSON endpoints, but as you saw, for example, Narodowy Bank Polski has XML format in responses. And these four points are very important when you are creating something, creating your tests. And do you know what does this mean, CRUD? You know, because you can see the picture. Okay, so there is a model that describes some possible operations on our entities. And usually, if you can use this model, you can use RESTful web service. Could anybody say, so we can see read here, what is another variant of this? What R mean in CRUD? So R can not only read but retrieve. Okay. So today we will talk about Postman. I will show you some deep points about SOAP UI. JMeter. We will just a few words about JMeter. So these tools can be used for testing of RESTful web services. And if you love programming, if you are so and Java. So I think that and you are automation engineer, probably the most useful tool will be Rest Assured. And if you like to program deeper, so there are can be more examples. Here are examples in Java, but of course in any programming language you there are a lot of different possible tools. So here is JMeter. Let's just a few words about JMeter. So mostly JMeter is used for performance testing, but you can record, for example, record your requests while during opening some pages, and you can write everything that is going on your web application. So sometimes. It is sometimes, for especially for people who just create performance test scripts and mostly work with performance, for them it would be better maybe sometimes using JMeter. I forgot to mention here, so if you like Scala, you can of course use Gutling, for example. And here we can use a lot of different possible tools. Let's talk about Postman. So maybe you have experience with Postman, like Chrome. Chrome plugin, but as you know, Postman, so they recommend not to use plugin, but use native applications, and in this case you can have more abilities. And in future this Chrome plugins will be like, maybe not in future, they are probably deprecated. So if you are opening Postman in Chrome, you can see like this message, that message on the yellow color, that it would be better to use native application. So you can just download and use them. Here just a few words about possibilities of Postman. So you can create requests. REST, so you can test REST. Of course, you can test SOAP, but I think that it's not as useful as you can, for example, do in with SOAP UI, for example, because you are working with XMLs, and here you have to. Copy just your body without some maybe in SOAP UI it's more useful to manipulate with this XMLs. With Postman you can create collections of tests. So you can call not collection but test sets or test suites. Well, so as we saw on a real example, we can see that SOAP request to a SOAP web service can look like this. So it has such a body with some header and body of body. As we can see, here you can mention your, for example, methods or some variables can define or type something. And here, example, maybe it's one of the possible example. It's like probably it was like national Bank of Russia, but probably for Polish bank it can look like it looks like this. In example list there are like NIS service, Polish National Bank or something else, and you can just take and create your own request and somehow process this. And tools that we can use. As you can imagine, so probably the set of tools is the same, I would like to mention that if you are using Java, for example, Axis tool is very useful to generate your methods. Like for example, SOAP UI generates in useful your form. In Axis, if you are downloading this, there are like scripts that can generate everything that is important for this. And using these examples generated automatically, you can use this in your Java code. Of course, you can use Rest Assured or some clients. But for these cases, probably you have to add more wrappers. So you have to program something. And if you're interested in this, I think very good source is W3 schools. So about it's like the source of information and some links about SOAP UI. The first possible task, if you're interested in this, I think that it would be better to create a project. For example, with SOAP UI, and you can use SOAP or REST service. There are links. Before there were links about this for both types of services. And for example, you can just generate temperature in San Francisco in 9 a.m. For example, for tomorrow or today. And validate if it is greater than zero, for example, or lower than zero, for example. I think if you don't have, for example, experience with SOAP UI or even with Rest Assured, this would be like a good first point, good basis for your knowledge. Do you have any questions for the first part? Yes, yes. Please.
It's not mostly about testing API. I would like to ask you about HTTP2 and JMeter. Because we use JMeter generally for testing our performance of web services. And we found such thing that, for example, we can't use JMeter for HTTP second. Have you participated in projects where you use HTTP2? And how you deal with performance calculation for this?
Do you mean that what I would recommend for performance of HTTP requests or? Yes.
With HTTP 1.
Yes.
But
I see.
Mm-hmm. Do you have such cases or not?
Well, in my current project, I am not in the like performance team, and our performance team uses Load Runner. I think that this is like professional tool. But if we are talking about open source like JMeter or Gatling, actually, I'm not aware about this. Okay. So I think it's just an interesting question, maybe for the next topics. So, well, and today I decided to go deeper with some SOAP UI topics because just a few words about again about tools. So even in our company recently, a few weeks ago, we had like a mail where some developer asked QA guys what to use, what he can use for web service testing. And there were different answers. And after this, our guys decided to make like some quiz and we analyzed. So a lot of guys are using, for example, if we are talking about automation testing, a lot of guys are using Rest Assured. Probably this is the most widely used within automated teams. If we are talking about manual testing, many guys know about Postman. Somebody knows about this Newman, and this is very another famous tool, another popular tool too. But if we are talking about, for example, if you like to create something fast, if you are not like, if you are in the beginning of programming, so you are in, you are learning programming, so probably SOAP UI can be just a good compromise between creation of something manually and between some programmatic parts. So you can, I will show you how can you use, for example, Groovy, and in which cases you can use. So there are a lot of points that I used with SOAP UI. So that is why I have chosen SOAP UI. And I think that for maybe some future sessions, maybe for IT Talks or maybe Vrotka, so I think Rest Assured would be a very good topic for, firstly, you can to create your you can create a project file for your test. So you can somehow you can have a separate file that stores all information regarding your requests to some web service. So, for example, you have one web service for I think, for example, to process your to exchange money, for example, another web service for let's take for example books. So you can have a separate project files. So usually it is an XML XML format. And you can store them. You can, for example, give your project file to somebody, for example, send it, or use it, for example, on your continuous integration. Further, I will show you how to do this. You can have properties. There are properties for projects, test suites, test cases. This is very customizable. For example, you can have like a drop down for with the list of your for example, you have staging, you have production, and maybe you have some number of web of URLs for your service. So you can just take your own variable for your, for example, URL, or for example, for some cases you need you are waiting for a status code like 404 and sometimes just 200. So, and you can just have like a dictionary with this possible variables. This looks like this. You can have project properties. You can transfer properties from one entity of a test case to another another one, and there is like a small tutorial that describes all this points. And to expand for property expansion, you can use just write like your variables like this. So just project property name, and so there's many possibilities. There are a lot of possible assertions, like for example, like we have so many assertions in TestNG, so here we have a lot of possible assertions. So we can assert XPath, XQuery, JSON path, etc. So usually it looks like this. So we create a test case, we add assertion, and assertion here, for example, and here we can see the result. So you can see that this is green, so everything works fine. For example, we have to assert that this date. So we can access this this part of XML by XPath and assert that it has like this regex. Or we can validate something else, for example, JSON path. JSON path, it's like another variant, another possible variant to access something in JSON. Here you can just write your JSON path expression, for example, select from this three possible variants. And you can look here, you can see just list of possible assertions. So you can assert status, standards of your HTTP compliance scheme. You can check some fault. So in SOAP you can have some fault requests, some parts of SOAP requests. So a lot of already available assertions that you can choose from the drop down and use them. And very like flexible assertion is assertion script assertion. So here is an example of Groovy script. So it looks like so here you assert the time is smaller than 400 milliseconds, for example. Here is like XML holder that so this is like a class to work with XMLs, and here you can assert that your XML has this this is BYR part. And another, so you have XML holder, and for JSONs, good choice is JSON slopper. So you can manipulate with different JSONs by this class. Other possible assertions, so you can as you know, SOAP UI can work not only with some web services, but it can validate JDBC. I've heard a few projects that work even with databases. You can work with JMS, so that is why we chose this in our project, but after some time we chose another tool, and we can validate somehow security. No, it's not like the best variant to validate security by this, but you have this opportunity. And Groovy scripts. So for scripting, you can manipulate with your requests very, very flexible. So you can lock something if you are debugging. This is just by the way, this is a good like a good variant to debug your test cases here. So you can see like this your information, so it is here. So here you can see error. So look, error, you can see this is in red, and here this is in green. So and by this, you can add something in your reports, or further, I will show you how to create your customized reports. For scripts, we can have like a test step with a script, or we can have like setup or tear down scripts. Like we can have like analogy between like this SOAP UI and, for example, TestNG. So we have before test, after test, before method, after method. So here we have setup and tear down. Setup and tear down, before test case, after test case, and projects. So here is like this tab where you can input your script. And by this, so this is like not a feature of this free. So today I am showing you like free variant of SOAP UI. This company SmartBeer have another variant. It's called Ready API, and you can. Actually, I have small experience with this, and I think that probably if you have experience with Java, I think rest assured, or some HTTP clients are better than this tool. But if you have a team with manual engineers who are testing manually, who are not who don't have big experience, for example, in Java, probably this would be like a better variant. And here for SOAP UI, for free variant, there is no like out of the box possibility of data driven testing. But with Groovy scripting, we can create your data-driven testing. Does anybody have idea why do we need this data-driven tests? Why can't we use just loop and that's all? Yes, correct. You are correct. But the question is, for example, you have like login operation, and you have two users, for example. For example, one user can be, for example, Marek, another user can be Pavel. for example. And the first user has, for example, correct password, another one has incorrect password. As you said, we can, by one test, can check for both users, check this scenario, correct? But why can't we use loop, just loop? So we can, for example, we have like these two users for example, CSV file. Yes, these users and the passwords of these users. And we can, our method can read this CSV file and somehow invoke our test method in a loop. So why do we need exactly data-driven format? We'll make what? Parallel, yes, and but if we don't need parallel, maybe someone. So in my opinion, we need to just not only just invoke our test in a loop, but we somehow need to handle, for example, cases when we have errors. So if we just invoke in a loop something, and we have like one scenario fails, in a loop. Our test case will stop and that's all. But if we have just data-driven method of invocation of our test, so in this case, we will handle this case. So we will invoke these two variants separately. And another aspect of this, we will see these cases separately in our reports. So in our reports, we will see two different invocations, not only one. Okay, so so here you can see just how you can somehow create data-driven. It's not like pure data-driven, but it's like similar. So you can use just your variables, this is very important, and you just have to create a script, and here you can see just some loop where you invoking test runner and invoking your steps, and here you just going in a loop by your steps. And another interesting topic is custom reporting. So if you need not just test JUnit like JUnit style report, or because I have just my example in my team, we need very customizable, very special report. That is why we can't use, for example, Allure, for example. And in such cases, we can use scripting, and we can use, for example, tear down script. So when the test is finishing, we can do something. We can get some information and, for example, generate some HTML. So here is an example. Probably after the meeting, I will share this script if you are interested, and share the link maybe on the GitHub. So if you are creating this script and using, so here you can see just some counters that you can use and get. And here you can just use these counters. So total test cases, how many test cases failed in total, how many succeeded, how many steps, how many assertions were asserted, etc. So here you can get all possible information from this SOAP UI. And one more thing that we can use, so we can not only just invoke manually SOAP UI. So for first steps, it's useful to invoke it manually, but sometimes we have to just execute tests from the command line. There is like test runner. Even test runner, and you have this test runner feature even in open, not open, free variant of SOAP UI. So you just need, one second, I just show you. Just a second. Not in this case, but we can create a to test case. We can create our test case. And in a test case, we can launch the test runner. So here you can see how to execute your test case from command line. So here is like it is invoked from the UI, but after this, you can just launch. Maybe we have to save our project. Just a second. I'm sorry, it's difficult from this part. Save project as, okay, well, and here, let's launch, oh, yes, so you can see that here is the command line that is invoked, it's invoked, and you can see some statuses, assertion, finished. Here you can copy how can you invoke your test without this UI. So you can just copy your this command line, and I will show you. I will give you in the presentation. There is on your the URL which options can you use. So you can with this command line you can just for example choose. How to generate in JUnit style, where the report should be generated, etc. So a lot of different possibilities. Just let's return. So here is an example, and here are examples of options that you can use. So project properties, you can just use invoke your project with some properties, and these properties can be processed somehow, as I mentioned. So for example, property you can use your URL of your website. You can, in one case, you can use staging. In another case, you can use some staging one, or in another case, staging two. And and another possible variant is just you can, if it is a script, you just can invoke it from your continuous integration. So it's one possible variant how you can integrate it with continuous integration. For example, Jenkins. The following topic is logs. So by default, you can see it is not the last. The last one is 5.4, but I think 99% of what I am talking about today, it's correct for this version 2, the last version 2. So here are like a few logs. Here is like XML with settings of the logs, additional logs of errors, and Groovy scripts. And these logs you can check even from the UI. And one possible widespread operation that is used is authorization. So, of course, you can check your web service without authorization, but I think that most web services work with not by HTTP but by HTTPS protocol. They have some authorization, and you have to. So the service somehow can understand that you are authorized to work with it. So this is like an example from Twitter. So you just have to register there and register your key. So steps how to run. So here is like link that describes everything that I am showing here. You just need to show you here is your token. You need to register on the Twitter site and generate your token. Here is script, Groovy script that uses your token and generates what you have to set in this bearer property of your request. And then you have to somehow to process the answer of the web service. So you have here, and then you can just get, for example, statuses, Twitter statuses. So. Here is like small example where you have like a few steps. Firstly, you generate bearer, you authorize, then you are getting access token, and then you can manipulate with some tweets. So here you are getting tweets, and it is like very big a web service with a lot of methods, so you can just open and manipulate. So if you are testing some web service, so this would be like, these steps would be like very popular. You will add them, you will add them into a lot of tests, like you will have like these steps and something that tests, for example, tweets. I will share this example, and here you can just get all details of this. Sorry for this. Here is an example how can you connect your SOAP UI project. So, for example, you have like you created project, you test, but you have to connect it with Maven and then connect with Jenkins. So you have to create a project with the following structure. It's like usual structure of a Java project with Maven, for example. And in resources, test resources, you have to put your project file with everything that you created. This is general structure of your project, and just a second. So if you are running this test, you will have the following structure. So you will have a target with this. So here will be just your jar file that will have your project. At this point, you can just generate this jar file and use it separately, but probably it would be better to use it together with Maven and POM XML file. And here you can use some input files, etc. And here you can see the examples of invocation of this project. So just it's like trainer, как usual build, Maven build, build success. Here you can see some statistics of the execution. And after this execution, you can, there are some points how to set up this, and you can have like outputs, for example, JUnit style reports in places where you need, etc. So you can use some variables here. So like it would be like a usual any other Java project where you can use environment variables, generate reports, etc. I mean Java tests written in Java. So here is like small part that we have to include into our POM XML file. So we have to use this this artifact. Here is example how to create this artifact. Here is important plugin and dependency. Dependency JUnit should be here. Probably here is an interesting question about JUnit 5. I don't know how to use this with JUnit 5, and I think even this everything that I'm showing you, it's like it is supported, but not as well as like UI testing, and that is why I don't think that it's the support for such things like JUnit 5 are good for in this case. And here is like example of so what is important. So here you we need these dependencies to for our build because if we don't have such dependencies the project won't build. And here you can use so you can customize where using reports and where is your project file, etc. And with Maven, you can use additional jars. You can add new modules, like in any Java project. And one possible. It's not widely used, but very interesting topic, especially for me, because, for example, I am using listeners, TestNG listeners, to create some customized reports in my project. So here we can have something like this. So we can listen some events of SOAP UI and create our some, for example, customized reports. So we have to use such XML files, such XML file by this put this XML file here, and we have to compile our listener. It's like just a simple example. Here is like a simple working example of our listener. So is it, could you see it? No? Okay. So okay, in when we send you like your the slides, so I will do another variant. It's like a listener for SOAP UI. So probably it's something like a listener for JUnit or for TestNG, but yes. SOAP UI is written in Java. Actually, today I was showing you like variants. So there are a few possible variants. Of course, there you can choose platform, and for example, you have Windows. Let's consider Windows. There are one possible variant is setup file exe, and another variant is zip file. And you can download this zip file, and you should have Java installed on your computer, like here, because without Java it won't work. And of course, if you are working with, for example, Maven, or you are working with this listener, of course you need Java. Well, so, and here you can see results. So we are just adding some information into our log, for example. So receiving a response, sending request. Here we are adding just in log, but of course you can create your report in your format. This is just simple details. There are two books about SOAP UI. Maybe they are not like from the last years, but still a lot of things work from them. And JSON path is not like widely used, but I know that sometimes it's used in Java developers use it this, and JSON path somehow implemented in SOAP UI, and it's used. Not everything works fine that you can just find there. So sometimes there are some errors with this. So and sometimes I recommend you to use, for example, JSON Slapper to manipulate with JSONs within SOAP UI. Here is like how to run tests. So here there are options to run tests from the command line. Source code, you can find there is source code on GitHub. So you can, if you are just working with some, for example, Groovy scripts, or you are creating your listener, you can just check which variables can you use, because generally such deep things like Groovy scripting or listeners, etc. So sometimes they are not described well, and sometimes you have to Google information. So, and sometimes if you understand Java code, you can just check this, because in my project one guy investigated this project on GitHub. Here is example how to connect Maven and SOAP UI. Here is like source code and how to extend listeners, create your listeners. And here is Java doc with some important, some useful information too. And if you are interested in Groovy, so there are some examples of scripts for SOAP UI, so they are really useful if you are using this. How to assert, how to manipulate with JSONs, etc. And one more possible task if you are interested in this. So if you like to somehow to go deeper, you can create your own XML file as a report. And it would be better to create, for example, data-driven test using Excel file or CSV file or your source. And I think it's interesting to connect SOAP UI project with Maven, for example. So questions. Do you have any questions? Yes, probably there were some special topics that nobody has questions. Okay, thank you very much for attention.